What diet will you advise post-operatively?
Sir, I will advise clear liquid, sir.
For how long?
Sir, for 2 weeks, we advise clear liquid, sir. A liquid diet.
2 weeks, clear liquid.
No, sir, liquid diet,
The
sir.
child is going to howl. Liquid or semi-solid, depending on what the child is used to, there is no harm in starting formula foods. There is no harm in starting. They want to give anything, make sure it is completely mashed so that there is no particulate matter. Ah, by the way, forgot. What is the suture material you use for closing?
Sir,
Nasal mucosa muscle, nasal mucosa muscle, and oral mucosa. Tell me.
sir, nasal mucosa, sir, I use with the sir, both nasal and oral mucosa, I close with the Vicryl, sir. For nasal mucosa, I use 5-O Vicryl, and muscle and oral mucosa with 4-O Vicryl, sir.
4-0 Vicryl, 5-0, it depends. If the child is more than 1.5 years, 5-0 is too small. So, okay, that I'm not arguing. Round body or cutting?
Sir, cutting we use, sir.
Really? Why? Why would you use cutting needle? Is it a tough structure?
It's not
Is
a
it a
tough
tough structure that the... Then? The moment you have a cutting needle, even you have a reverse cutting needle, your chances of the suture cutting through are extremely high. If you have been getting away with it, I have no arguments. You have been lucky. When you are doing the nasal mucosa, please make it a point to ask for 4-0 or 5-0 on a round body needle. There is no advantage using a cutting needle. Absolutely zero advantage. Where there is no mucoperiosteum, just mucosa. Do you think you're going to have a problem? Why do you use a cutting needle only when the tissue is tough, no?
Yes, sir.
Why would you use a cutting needle here? You pass a round body needle, it's a nice clean round hole. You tighten it, if this even is under little tension, it's not going to tear through. Even if you use a reverse cutting, theoretically the flat side is on the inner side. So, but it doesn't work that way. A round body is the best. Okay, you can quote me on this.
Yes, sir.
If you don't have anything, best please use a cutting needle. But please ask for a round body. It's freely available. It's a lovely suture material. Round body is necessary for the nasal mucosa for the simple reason it is a very thin structure. And you're less likely to cause tears. Oral mucosa, you want to use Vicryl, you said.
Yes, sir.
Why? Why? Why not monocryl? No, don't tell me I'm doing it in my unit. You need to start thinking for yourself. I am telling you I would use monocryl 99 times out of 100. Now you tell me why. Common sense, no, madam? Vicryl is a braided suture, no?
Yes, sir.
So all food and milk and all that crap is going to get stuck in the braids.
Yes, sir.
Whereas if you use a monofilament, there's less chance of it getting stuck, no? Correct or no?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So as far as possible, use monofilament suture for the... Nobody's going to flunk you, okay, if you say Vicryl. I'm just trying to say you need to have your thoughts in order why you do a particular thing. What about the muscle?
Muscle also, sir. I suture with the 4-0 Vicryl, sir.
Everything is Vicryl only. Okay. Again, I don't have argument. People either use monocryl or Somerled uses nylon. Okay. He uses 4-0 ethylon for the muscles because he needs a lot of strength and a lot of holding. For otherwise, they tend to drift apart or drift anteriorly. So, but I have no argument. If that, my only argument was against using in the oral mucosa. What else technical? Sandeep, you want to ask anything about the technical aspect?
No, sir. Just, nothing from my side, sir.
About everything. All right. Yeah. All right. Let's go to a little bit of post management. The child, what we do is give the child liquids or semi-solids for around 7 to 10 days. And after that, we tell them to eat whatever the child wants. Most important, if the child is used to a particular kind of food and you deny it in the post-op period, the child is going to howl. And trust me, it's better to keep the child happy and take a small risk of a little small hole appearing here and there rather than let the child keep on crying non-stop for whatever he or she wants. Okay, child's comfort is probably more important than the, you know. And Ian Jackson, though, I remember he used to say, whatever you are giving before, you give immediately. Day two, next day, once you make sure that no bleeding has occurred, you don't have to, the chance of re-exploration, all that have gone down, give the child whatever, whatever. Okay, if your repair is good and tension-free, it shouldn't really make a difference because mucosal things heal very fast. All right. Now, what is the role of speech therapy?
Speech therapy, sir. With speech therapy, we try to omit the sir. We try to improve the outcome of for the speech, sir. So in the speech therapy, patient the speech therapist trained the patient that what he first assess the patient. He first assess the patient.
I make a statement to you. You operate a child at the age of 10 months. The child is non-syndromic. The child is non-syndromic, child is of good health, no predisposing factors. You do a very competent muscle repair and the palate length and everything is adequate. Basically, in short, everything has gone as per your plan. Does this child require speech therapy or not?
Sir, this child will require speech therapy, sir.
No, stop. You know about policization? You know about policization, no?
Yes.
You know, no? You have congenital thumb absence, radial club hand, where you do an index finger policization.
Yes, sir.
Have you seen it?
No, sir. I have not seen it, sir.
You read it, at least read about it?
Yes, sir. I have read it, sir.
What age would you do this? That's okay. What age would you do this? What age will you do it?
Yes, sir.
You do it again before around 11
yes,
months. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Because you want the prehensile activity of the thumb to be used. Correct?
Yes, sir.
What physiotherapy do you give a 11-month-old child?
Sir, according to the sir.
Nothing. Nothing. Don't even bother nothing. Answering. Nothing. Okay. There is no physiotherapy you can give for a 11-month-old child. Okay, basically you just encourage the child to do as many normal activities as possible. And if you have done your policization properly and brought it in the right axis, the child will automatically start using it like a thumb. Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Exactly. So in a palate, it's a similar situation. When you restore the speech mechanism to as near normal as possible, leave the child to develop on its own.
Sir,
if you have restored a normal speech, yes.
Sir, I have one doubt, sir. In the smile train, sir, it is given there that after the repair, we have to send the child for speech therapy. We should send the child at around 18 months to 2 years. Sir. I just have this doubt, sir. Whether we have to send
it. Yes, but this is mostly so that the therapist listens. The therapist listens, doesn't do anything. You have to make the child read normally, look at pictures, come out with words, encourage the child to speak as much as possible, and then listen to see if there is any distortion or anything. Okay, what I'm going to say is all factors being equal and if all factors are favorable, speech therapy in these cases is highly overrated. You can't give speech therapy in a 15-16-month-old child. What are you going to do? The child is barely speaking sentences. What you can do is listen and tell the parents to listen. This is not proper. This is being mispronounced. And you need to sit and... So active speech therapy is only needed if you're ticking one of these boxes. Child operated late, syndromic child, mentally child is not all there, parents are uneducated, all these things, you look any of these sort of negative factors come, that is when you need to think seriously of speech therapy. Now tell me something about faulty speech. Just 1 second, 1 second.
Yes. Thank you.
Yeah, sorry. So now where were we? Tell me what are the problems in speech?
Sir,
in cleft palate.
Sir, two type of errors are present in the sir cleft palate speech, sir. First is the obligatory error, sir, and second is the compensatory error, sir. In obligatory error, sir, which are present due to the interference in the structural abnormalities. So this can be corrected with the surgery, but speech therapy will not act much, sir. And compensatory errors are
Why speech therapy will not act?
So, like, first we have to correct the this anatomical defect, sir. Whatever anatomical defect is present, sir. And then we have to send for the speech therapy, sir.
All right. Speech defects are basically errors of articulation and errors of hypernasality. Errors of articulation can be several. They can be substitutions, they can be omissions, they can be a whole lot of things. You should ask Rajesh Pawar to take a talk on speech in cleft palate. And the other thing is nasality. Speech therapy cannot correct nasality unless it has been proved that the child is what is called as a lazy child. The child has got everything in position but is not using it because for whatever reason. Speech therapy can correct only articulatory problems. Articulatory problems are those of errors of omission. Errors of omission means for kaka, they will say a-a. And errors of substitution for kaka, they will say tata. So that is a substitution. So that all those can be corrected with speech therapy, not the hypernasality. Speech therapists cannot make a velopharyngeally incompetent palate suddenly competent. So the role of speech therapy, it's a constant dialogue. You have to see if you have a secondary patient coming to you at the age of 4.5 years when you assess before going to school, you have to see what kind of abnormalities are there. Are they the ones that are correctable by speech therapy, or does the child require redo surgery on the palate with a redo of the whole thing and restoring the speech mechanism? So speech therapy, the therapist has to have a very sharp ear to pick out. Okay, and whenever you do secondary surgery for first of all, if you see do operate a patient at the right time under the right circumstances with the right technique, surgery has gone off well, no fistula, nothing, you can be reasonably sure if you operated before the age of 1 year that the child is going to have an 80%, at least 70% chance the child's speech will be normal. That is what you need to aim for. At the same time, you need to tell the send the child to therapist. Just child is babbling, and the therapist listens with a sharp ear and identifies the problems. There is no real speech therapy that is given probably till the age of 2 years or after that, because you can't really give therapy. You can just encourage the child to read, but you can't give active speech therapy. Now, when you are doing secondary surgery of the palate, it has to be a consensus decision between the speech therapist and you, that the child has to reach a plateau in speech therapy, saying that after this, no further improvement is possible. Now you need to consider the possibility of repeat surgery to improve the speech. Now, before we wind up, I just like to ask you, what are your concepts on pharyngeal flaps and how do they work? Secondary speech problems, I'll give you a brief thing about nasendoscopy and lateral video fluoroscopy. Nasendoscopy is basically you put in ideally a small fiber optic scope. You look at the palate closure, and if in secondary in pharyngoplasty or rather operations on the posterior pharyngeal palatal part, there is a simple aphorism: if something is moving, don't touch it. What is not moving, try to change that. So if you are seeing a good palatal movement anteroposteriorly, but it's failing to reach the posterior pharyngeal wall and the lateral orifices are not moving at all, you need to consider something that will bring the lateral walls a little closer, and if possible, augment the posterior pharyngeal wall so that the palate will hit it. Typically, that is a Hynes pharyngoplasty. If there is no anteroposterior movement at all, no anterior posterior movement, then and the lateral walls are attempting to move, do not touch them. Do not touch them because they are already moving. You need to do something to bring this behind. And that is where a pharyngeal flap, I have not done a pharyngeal flap for the last 15 years. And I'm never going to do the procedure again because it's a very morbid procedure. But you need to know about it as far as the exceptions are concerned. What is your concept of a pharyngeal flap, madam?
Sir, this pharyngeal flap, this function as the central obturator of the velocipharyngeal pharyngeal sir, port.
So, very good. So, that's the first and most important thing. It's an obturator. Okay, it's just an obturator. It has no dynamic role. It is just an obturator, and you're hoping that the obturator is right in the middle and the side walls are coming close and blocking the orifice. All right, then what is the difference between superior base pharyngeal flap and inferiorly base pharyngeal flap?
Between both kind of flaps, sir.
Sorry?
Yes, I'm not able to get you, sir. Your voice was not clear, sir.
What is the difference between a superiorly based pharyngeal flap and an inferiorly based pharyngeal flap? Don't tell me one is based superiorly and one is. What are the issues regarding superiorly based pharyngeal flap and inferiorly based pharyngeal flap? Do you know about it?
Sir, not much clear, but sir, this inferior pharyngeal flap it pulls the soft palate inferiorly, sir, and posteriorly, and it decreases the mobility. So that's why the inferiorly based pharyngeal flap is not much indicated now, sir.
No, that's not correct. That's not correct. You have not got the concept at all. This is the pharynx. The top is top, bottom is bottom. A superiorly based pharyngeal flap is raised like this. Are you clear?
Yes, sir.
What thickness is this flap raised?
Sir?
This flap has to be raised, no, madam?
Yes, sir.
How thick is this flap?
I'm not sure, sir. Yes, sir.
There's no sure. Either you don't know. This is a full thickness pharynx. You see the glycerebral fascia. Okay, it's a full thickness pharyngeal flap. Are you understanding what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
Directly, you will see the prevertebral fascia now. So you raise it. Okay, you raise a superior base pharyngeal flap. Okay, now I'm releasing my left hand. This flap has come. This is the raw surface. Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
So it has to fit on a raw surface on the nasal mucosa.
Yes, sir.
Okay?
Yes, sir.
Now, the problem is that means you have to de-epithelize the nasal mucosa so that you have a raw area. This flap has come from here and is now sitting here. Have you got it?
Yes, sir.
But what about this part of the flap that is in the air? That is the bridge between the posterior pharyngeal wall and the palate. That is left raw?
Yes, sir.
Within 3 months, it will become a string. And it will become a superior pharyngeal string. Okay, so there is a way to take the same. If you are going to raise, put it on the nasal mucosa here, whatever is the raw here, nasal mucosa is turned back. I suggest you read it. This is called Hogan's modification, where he takes posteriorly based nasal mucosal flaps. This is the, so these nasal mucosal flaps are taken posteriorly based and they are used to line the raw surface of the pharyngeal flap. The problem with pharyngeal flaps is that they cause tremendous snoring and tremendous respiratory obstruction. If there is a slight cold or something like that, the thing gets completely blocked and the patient has to breathe through the mouth. It's a very nasty thing. And as you said correctly, it is just an obturator. So if you have to do a flap, do a superiorly based flap for several reasons. One is that in a superiorly based flap, the lower incision, if you commit to it and then you raise the flap and you find it's a little short, you can raise the flap some more. If you take an inferiorly based flap, that is this way, okay, it now goes on the oral side of the palate. So the palatal mucosa on the oral side can easily be, it's a technically easier procedure. The problem is that this upper incision will stop short where the adenoid tissue is, and that's a little friable. Okay, and if you raise this flap and find that it's short, you're sunk, because by merely increasing the base of the flap, you're not going to increase the reach. And basic transposition flap principle, if you merely take the base a little away, it's not going to reach. Whereas superior base flap, you have the option, if it is not reaching, you can elevate a little more and then make it sit there. The big only advantage, what happens is that whenever you take a pharyngeal flap and you close the defect in the pharynx, it's going to be a straight line closure. That is going to contract. So 6 months after doing the procedure, if somebody is able to say whether a superiorly based flap was used or inferiorly based flap was used, I will give him a gold medal. It's not possible, because the base of the flap migrates in the opposite direction. If you take a superiorly based pharyngeal flap, 6 months later, the base of the flap has migrated here. And if you take an inferiorly based pharyngeal flap, the base is going to migrate out.
Yes.
Okay. So you will not be able to make out. The other huge advantage of a superiorly based flap is, if you have bleeding from the bed, you don't have to undo the flap in order to get access to it, because superiorly based flap, please try and imagine, this is a pharynx, this is a superior flap, you raised it. And if you have bleeding, you are seeing the place where you raise the flap from directly. If it's an inferiorly based flap and God forbid you have bleeding, you have to disconnect the flap and then you'll be able to see the bed. For all these reasons, if you do prefer, use a superiorly based flap. And but it's a morbid procedure. Better idea is to do a redo palate, if necessary. Refer to somebody who's doing it. Re-establish the moving mechanism as far back as possible. And insofar as you do something like a Hines pharyngoplasty, where basically you augment the posterior pharyngeal wall with the salpingopharyngeus mucomuscular flaps, so that you bring the posterior pharyngeal wall a little ahead. You also narrow the velopharyngeal inlet, because these tissues are taken from the side. The pharyngeal size becomes a little smaller, and it's a far more physiological procedure. Now, what do we do, Sandeep? If there are any one or two questions she wants to ask, we have well past 2 hours. Otherwise,
sir, we have got 6 questions, sir. People have asked.
Yes.
They have actually put it in the chat box. Can I start off, sir?
Please do.
Yeah. Yeah, Dr. Dipankar has asked, sir, will you please explain the bilateral Vomer flap and FAM flap with diagram?
FAM flap?
Yeah.
FAM flap is different. FAM flap is a facial artery, it's a different flap. A buccal flap is basically a random pattern flap. It is centered on the, literally on the retromolar trigone, okay? And it goes straight out towards the angle of the mouth. The biggest advantage of a buccal flap is, if it's raised from the cheek, this is the cheek, and I'm going to raise the buccal flap. It moves down like the page of a book. Okay, it moves down like the page of a book. So this part is the mucosal side. Okay, it goes to the nasal layer. So when it's used for the nasal layer, it exactly fits. If you have to use for the oral layer, it has to have a twist. Okay, remember, my palmar side is the epithelial surface, and the dorsal side is raw. So when I move it down for the nasal layer, it is perfect. The epithelial layer goes on the nasal side. But when I use it for the oral layer, I have to twist the flap. That is number one. A FAM flap, you know, is basically you identify the facial artery by Doppler, and either you can have a posterior, I don't know whether posterior, anteriorly, whatever, but you can also have the same facial artery coming from this side. So you can, you know, it's, you take the facial artery in the flap. That is the key. And we have done a few in our unit, and you take the mucosa, muscle, plus the facial artery in this flap, a very robust flap, because you're taking the entire facial artery. But it requires a lot of work. And as you come close to the angle of the mouth, the facial artery is very close to the oral commission. So you need to be careful that you don't distort that. That is as far as the FAM flap is concerned. It can be based either here, in which case it can be used for anterior palatal defects, or it can be based here, in which case it can be used for the nasal mucosa. A buccal flap is a random pattern flap, but because the blood supply near that retromolar trigone is so good, it always works. Coming to your second thing, bilateral vomerine flap. Let me just see if I can draw it. Okay, this is, can you see this this one here?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so that is a diagram splitting the vomer into two. The incision then curves around and goes into the septal mucosa, where it is raised to close the nostril floor. Now, so these vomerine flaps are superiorly based. You don't need to leave anything behind. Okay, see, vomerine flaps are raised. Basically, this is the vomer. This is the inferior surface. It is split here, and these flaps are raised up, leaving the raw vomer behind. Those, as far as there are other some tweaks which you can use in the vomer flap, which I took it when I took the Amrita class. They require sophisticated diagrams. I cannot do it here. Next question.
Yeah, again related to vomerine flaps, sir. Will you please how to cauterize raw area of vomer after palatoplasty, sir?
Okay.
Do we
need what we have started using? Yeah, what we have started doing is using a Colorado tip needle to make the incision. Okay, and I think my boys, if any of them is there, will bear this out, that we have significantly, we have first of all, touch wood, never taken a patient back for re-exploration because of bleeding from the vomerine raw area. It is one of those things that is inevitable. There is no amount of infiltration is going to help that. But if you make the initial cut with the Colorado tip needle, then you prevent active bleeding. And otherwise, you use a ball cautery or one of those bigger cauteries and literally burn the bone directly. And it stops. But yes, it can be a nuisance. Cutting with the using a Colorado tip needle is really good. It works.
Yeah. So then the next question is, where to place a knot in repairing oral and nasal mucosa and why?
Yeah, good question. See, you need to place the knot ideally on the epithelial surface. You don't need to be fanatic about it, but it's a good idea to place it on the epithelial surface. The other thing is the technique of suturing, which again, you have to hand it to the guy, Sommerlad. Okay. I'm going to show you on my hands. Now, this is the edge. Now, this is the nasal mucosa. So, we like to take inverted suture so that the knot comes on the nasal side. All right. This is the surgeon's view. Now, when you take the bite, take it 1 millimeter through from the edge of the nasal mucosa, but let it travel and come out much further away, say 3 to 4 millimeters through the submucosa and come out from here. Have you understood this? I have gone through this is the edge of the nasal mucosa. Let's say that I have gone very close to the edge of the nasal mucosa, but now I have traveled through the submucosal region and come out somewhere here, which is well away from the edge. And then repeat the process here also by going into the submucosa a good distance away from the edge, but coming out, leaving a very small mucosal edge between the needle and exit of the needle and the edge of the mucosa, very small distance. Now, when you tie this knot, it beautifully everts. You have to have an everting suture because this is better chance of remaining watertight. And if you can put the knot, if you do this, you will have an everting suture. That is the advantage of putting the knots on the nasal side. If you take a simple suture and tie it, it's not going to evert. Because that's not the direction of how the thing is being tied. So if you want eversion, use this technique close to mucosa, far away in the submucosa, far away from the submucosa, close to the mucosa, tie it. And as you keep, the knot will go off on the nasal side. For God's sake, don't do it in such a way that the thread is between the suture line, because that is, now you're asking for chances of fistula formation. Yeah. My preference to put on the mucosal side, but if you have to put it on the raw area also, you will not get the same degree of eversion, but you can still do it.
Perfect, sir.